Innovator Internship 2020 Learning Track. So, since the first day, you have been hearing a lot about design thinking and how it helps us in solving problems and all. So before getting started, I would just like to, you know, build an introduction. So for that, how many of you are kind of a fitness freak or interested more into building fitness or going to gym? Like yes or no? Anything like that in the chats? Yeah, great. So basically what we do in a gym or during fitness, we exercise our muscles to, oh, that's great. Walk for 6 kilometers. Nice. So basically what we do, we basically exercise our muscles so that we can get more of a stamina, more of a like power in our muscles and all. In the same way, our brain is also in a kind of a speaking. Our brain is also a muscle. The more you use it, the better it becomes. And great learning happens only if you go out of your comfort zone and practice your brain a lot. So that's what we are gonna do in this whole internship period. We will be taking you out of your comfort zones and like making you think, making you, you know, like what you call, think more and like think out of you, out of the perspectives and everything. मतलब आज तक जिस तरीके से सोच रखा है तुम लोगों ने, उससे थोड़ा different सोचवाना है तुम लोगों से, ताकि और अच्छे से सीख सको, right? So we have one brain gym freak with us, Rishi, and he is a Forbes 30 under 30 Asia class up to 18. He has also written a book called Arduino for Kids. So he'll be taking us through the introduction of design thinking. So over to you, Rishi.
Thank you for the introduction, Ishant. Can you all hear me well?
Yeah.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Perfect. So I have two requests. One is to, whenever you can, switch on your video, because otherwise it looks to me that I'm just talking to a screen with nobody actually seeing. If you can do that, that's one. And second, I would like for this to be collaborative, but you know, obviously with the number of people in the conversation, it will become quite difficult if everybody starts speaking. So all the questions, thoughts, doubt that you have, start dropping them in the comment section. Either Nishant or Dheeraj will sort of bring them up to my focus, and then we can address that question. All right. So now that is taken care of, let's get started. We are doing an introduction to design thinking. Some of you already know what it is. Some of you know a little bit about what it isn't, what you can use it for, so on and so forth. Before we get started, I have a few questions and stories for us to listen. What do you do if lions are coming to your field and eating all your cows? That's the question number one for the day. What do you do if lions are coming to your field and eating all your cows? And here is the story. This is the story of an 11-year-old kid in Kenya named Turere. And he wakes up every morning. He takes his cattle outside to graze the grass. And Kenya is known for one of the most fertile lands, also very, very flat surface. So you will see prairies, you will see savannas, you will see all of that, all the geographical locations that you have seen or read about in geography. You will hear about all of that in Kenya, right? It is full of that. What is Kenya also full of is lions. Now, Turere has an interesting problem to solve. His problem is that his source of livelihood and income, which is his cattle, the cows, are being attacked by vicious lions because lions get hungry. And this is not their natural habitat. And people have started sort of enforcing land and encroaching land and started building farms and, you know, moving into the lion's home, so to speak. So what lions do for lunch, breakfast, and dinner is they come and hunt the cows. Now, if you were in his space, how would you solve for this? this is where something interesting happens. Pereira realizes that he doesn't have a lot of money. He comes from a very poor background, doesn't have a lot of resources, but he realizes something which is interesting to him. One day he is running across the fields just for fun with a torch in his hand, and all the animals that see a torch sort of get startled and run away, saying, oh, there must be something there, so I'm not going to go close to that. It's the same concept when in a forest, if you're ever stuck, if you're going to light a source of light, it could be torch, it could be fire, animals will not come close to you because they are scared of that, because that is not natural to them. So he realizes that, okay, there is something that I can do with torch, which is scaring the animals away. What can I do with it in a way that, what can I build in such a way within my constraints that the lions stop coming and eating my cattle? Lo and behold, he does something interesting. He takes this torchlight, connects it to an old car battery, and then connects that to a solar panel. These are all within his constraints. A torchlight is very easily available. You can just take it from scrap. A car battery, an old car battery, is very easily available from the scrap. And a solar panel is also very easily available from the scrap. He connects all of them and realizes that one thing that he has noticed is animals get startled when there are uncommon patterns in light, which is to say, if I just switch on the light or switch off the light, animals will not care. But if I keep switching it on and off, animals would get really scared because something is going on. So what he does is he connects the solar panel with the battery and the battery with the torch and rigs it in such a way that the torch will go off at random occasions throughout the night. And just because of that, the lions stop coming to his field. This is the picture of the 11-year-old Pereira. This is story number one, where design thinking is knowingly, unknowingly the method he used. He understood what his constraints were. He understood what the core problems were. He understood what the actual behavior change he wants to drive and was able to bring all of these things together with the limited resources he had. Now I have story number two. What do you do if birds and stray animals are invading your fields and eating all your vegetables and fruits? Now this especially is a huge problem in India, where the farms are small, the produce is small, but there are a lot of stray animals and the fields are open. We are not in greenhouse, we don't grow our vegetables in greenhouses across India with almost 60% of a population in the agrarian economy. What do you do if you're going to be facing huge losses because a cow came and ate all your tomatoes? Or if a pig comes and ramshackles all your potato crops? Or if just birds are coming in and eating off all of your wheat produce? What do you do? In the current problems, in the situation that existed before, farmers would actually stay up all night in their fields, guarding their fields from animals, with lathis, with shoes, with chappals, with thali, so that they can make a lot of noise. And in the day, they would always make sure that there is somebody in the field around who can walk around and, you know, basically make the crows fly off or give the perception to an animal saying there is a human here, so don't come in. But that is not sustainable. So one genius mind, long, long time ago, did something interesting. The scarecrow. You may have seen this in fields across India. You may have seen it all around. And this is a brilliant innovation for this. The moment there is a beautiful figurine like that with glasses and all that, the animals think that, oh, there must be a person in there, so maybe I should not go. And the birds think, oh, wow, there is some danger, I should not go. I think my favorite one of the scarecrows that I saw, this was back in Uttar Pradesh, was when on the scarecrow, the farmers used a very loose kurta pajama. So every time there would be wind, the scarecrow would also move. And when there is also movement, animals and birds really think there is a person inside because they can't really tell the difference when they are scared. And that is how they save their crops. All right. Story number three. What do you do when there is no one to repair a $25,000 baby incubator and it becomes useless even after a minor glitch? So this is a real problem that happened. And this is something that the Western world has actually seen a lot more of now. They don't seem to understand the constraints in the developing world. And because they don't seem to understand the constraints, they have no idea what to do about them. So a few funding agencies in the US decide that a few African nations should be given baby incubators so that the infant mortality rate can go down. So what they do, because they have a lot of money, they get the best incubators there are with full pack of everything and ship them to African nations. 6 months later, when they go to these African nations, they realize that most of these incubators are now being used as storage devices. People open up the top of the incubator, they are putting some medicines in it. The incubators are plucked out of the power sockets and they're confused. They're like, what's going on? Why is nobody using sometimes $40,000 to $50,000 worth of equipment? Why is it that people are not using my incubators? And then they send a research team there. When they send the research team, they realize that incubators are great for the first week or so, but the moment anything wrong happens, none of the people there know how to fix the incubator. So the incubator becomes useless. They cannot fix the incubator, which means they cannot put a baby in it because a baby's life would be in threat. So they just unplug the incubator and use it as a storage device. The second research team goes there to identify what is really going on and what's the culture and what's the context and what are the constraints. So they realize that in East African nations, there are not a lot of new cars, but there are a lot of old cars and a good number of mechanics. Almost every household has their own mechanic. Most people don't come from income households where they can afford a new car. So they just take an old car from scrap, mix and match parts that they can figure out from the dump areas and build a new car out of it. So they realize that, okay, these people don't have money, constraint number one. Constraint number two, they don't have the skill sets in electronics. But what they do know is how to fix a car. What can I do with these constraints that I know they have and these skill sets I know they have and bring it to the problem that we have? A $30,000 to $45,000 incubator going for waste is a shame because it's a lot of money spent. This is where the design team comes up with an idea. They say, what would it take to make an incubator exclusively of the things that are available around them? Lo and behold, a baby incubator made completely from car parts. So in this, you will see there is a battery section here. You will see the control panel here. These are all taken from the dashboard. The glass is essentially coming from the windshields and that kind of stuff. The bars, all the electronics inside, the indicators here, they're all made out of car parts. The moment they introduced this, something changed. The neo nurture incubator sort of really changed the game because suddenly the community became self-reliant. If anything was to go wrong, they could just call up any mechanic saying, hey, Mr. X, my incubator is not working. Can you help us fix this? And this Mr. X is, because he knows cars, because he knows how electronics and mechanics works in a car, and that's his context and that's his skill, they come back, they apply all of it, and they fix the incubator. So now you have perpetually working incubators built out of locally available skills and a sustainable solution, which doesn't cost $25,000 to $40,000. It only costs the value of car parts. And that's how you're saving lives. Story number four. How do you bring blood tests for malaria to millions of people when blood centrifuge costs are so high, bulky, and inaccessible? Now, this is one of my favorite stories to tell. As many of you may already know, malaria is a huge crisis. Malaria, dengue, malaria and dengue. Let's speak about those primarily. Those are huge problems that especially the developing nations like India face. India, Bangladesh, Pakistan, Brazil, all the economies which are agrarian in nature, which have pollution issues, which have population issues, they also have a malaria issue. They also have a dengue issue. Every time there's an outbreak, it goes for a mess. The only way to sort of identify whether it is a malaria, dengue, or any other fever is to go for a blood test. Now, typically how a blood test functions is you give a sample of your blood, they put it in a high centrifuge, and as the blood goes around in centrifuge, the components of the blood separate. The plasmas, the leukocytes, the neocytes, the RBCs, WBCs, platelets, everything separates. And once that separates, you can take a part of the blood sample, put it under a microscope and find out, okay, is there an infection of the so-and-so virus that we assume? Now, these centrifuges are extremely expensive. Like even in the laboratories in India, these typically cost between 50,000 rupees to a lakh and sometimes a lot more, depending on their capacity. Now, one interesting problem that people realized is we cannot solve for malaria if we don't even know if there is malaria. We need to first identify if there is malaria. How do you give somebody a medicine for malaria if you don't even know if they have it? And how can you identify if they how can you identify whether or not they have it if you don't have the equipment to test for it? Constraints. One, the cost of the equipment. Second, accessibility of the equipment. How many people have access and distribution to that kind of equipment? Third, how easily can I maintain it? Fourth, how easily can I produce it? These are the constraints that these scientists were working with. And one of my favorite scientists, Dr. Manu Prakash, he works at Stanford University, loves building toys and loves playing with toys. So he comes up with a unique solution. This is called the Paperfuge. Now, Paperfuge is a game. This is a game that you would have played as a child. You put a disc in the center, you put two strings on the side, and you open it up and you close it. You open it up and you close it. Through experiments, they realized that when you do that multiple times, the thread which is going to be sort of tangling with each other, it creates a new way of being pulled. And sometimes the speed of the centrifuge is so high that it actually is 1.5 times better than the speeds of actual centrifuges. And he was like, okay, let me see how much money will it take for me to do this. He's also a bioscientist. So he was like, okay, I know that blood is going to get separated at so and so speeds. And I only need a very small capillary for doing it. Let me see if I can mix the concept of this toy and the centrifuge concept from physics and my understanding from biochemistry. Brings it all together and says, okay, let me take a small capillary, put it in the piece of the paper in the center with a small sample of blood and just do this for 10 seconds. Let me see what comes out of it. Lo and behold, they realized that they can solve the exact problem that the centrifuge has solved with a lot of money being spent and qualified technicians just to operate the centrifuge with a 20 cent paperfuge. This was covered widely by the Wired magazine, by the New York Times, by whatever else. They took the cost of a centrifuge, say about $1,000, put it to 20 cents. Now imagine the capability of this. Imagine what you can do when you take away the constraints of costs, of distribution, of accessibility, of education, none of that. Now, I don't need somebody to be a certified lab technician and have gone through 18 years, 20 years of education to operate a machine. All they need to know is how to operate this simple toy, and it takes away everything else. That's my fourth story for the day. Now, how is this connected to design thinking? What is design thinking? Design thinking is a collaborative interdisciplinary approach to developing human-centered solutions with an iterative process. Now, while that sounds like a wishy-washy, let me speak to you a little bit more in detail. What does this really mean? Collaborative, well, you already know what this is. You essentially speak to a lot of people, you bring a lot of different streams together, you work with them, you understand, you analyze, you empathize, you ideate, you solve. It's always a collaborative solution. I sometimes jokingly say that the only place where diversity really, really works in the real world is in design thinking, because you cannot just have one train of thought and solve for a solution. Manu Prakash, if he did not have understanding of toys and physics and of human constraints and of blood tests, he would not have been able to do this. If Turere, the first person that I spoke to you about, if he did not have understanding of electronics or access to people who understand electronics and understanding animal behavior while also being able to understand his own constraints he will not be able to do that. So you need people to sort of being able to work with it. And this is where the beauty comes in. When you're working with people who have different skill sets, they all come together and collaborate, the magic happens. Interdisciplinary approach, like I touched upon a little bit briefly.
Hello.
Sorry, am I hearing something? All right, I'll continue. I request you to mute your mics for a bit, and I will open up for Q&As in some time. Interdisciplinary approach, you cannot have just one discipline. You need to have multiple disciplines of people that you're working with. It does not have to do with your degrees. It has to do with how you think. I could, by qualification, I'm an engineer, but what I like doing is understanding human behavior, and how I express it is through writing books, through teaching, through building products, so on and so forth. Right, so you have to go a little bit inside and understand analytically to yourself what your skill sets are and what kind of disciplines do you cut across. Human-centered, at the center of everything is human. We are not building solutions for a machine, not a system, a human. I am building this solution in case of the farmers and scarecrows, where I can bring more ease to the humans. I can bring more stability to the humans. I'm building in case of malaria, so that I can bring more health to a human. I can solve those problems. It always goes back to the human story. Iterative process. Design thinking is not like a Laplace equation. You don't have a set of things that you have to do always to get to a conclusion. These are not dogmas, this is a process. Similar to how you make a roti, if some of you are cooking, or similarly, how you sort of approach writing code, or approach writing a book, approach writing an article, there's a process associated with it. These are high-level structures that you follow. This is not something that you write down and follow question by question, step by step. It's not an experiment, it's a process. And design thinking highlights 5 core steps in which you can sort of function. And we'll go a little bit deep into that, but let me speak to you about what you can actually do with design thinking. Design thinking helps you discover real user needs, define a problem statement, and eventually solve for real needs instead of perceived needs. Identify real problems that the user is facing. And we often tend to build solutions that we think to be the problems and not what people perceive to be the problems. So design thinking helps us bridge all of that. To give you an example on this, a couple of years ago, this was back in 2014, I spent some time in the Mumbai slums of Dharavi. And I grew up in Rajasthan. I'm technically from Uttar Pradesh. I grew up in Bangalore. I mean, I've been studying and living in Bangalore after that. So I know very little about what's going on in a slum. My understanding of the slum comes from Slumdog Millionaire. It comes from a little bit news articles I read now and then. But that's all I knew about it. So when I went into the field with my team, I was thinking that, oh, you know, maybe they don't have access to water, they don't have access to electricity, they don't have access to this, they don't have access to that, they don't have access to medical supplies, and maybe it will be very difficult because they're living in small spaces, so on and so forth. So these are the problems that I thought they had. So my first idea, of course, being an engineer, was, hey, what if I give them solar panels, and hey, what if I give them water purifiers, and what if I give them like ways in which they can convert water from humid air and so on and so forth. These were all the assumptions I was going with. And these are the problems that I was actually thinking in my mind. Oh, I can make that circuit. Oh, I can make that purifier. Oh, I can do this. I can make an app. I can do all of this. These are all the problems that I thought they had. Till I actually went into the field. And we started talking to the people around with very open-ended conversations. And this is a step called empathy, which I'm going to speak to you about in detail. We started talking to people, and that's when sort of my eyes opened up. All the facts remained similar. They still had small spaces that they lived in. They still had, you know, a bunch of problems with water supply and all of that. But what was very interesting for me to see is that this community was self-sustainable. They figured out how to get battery connections. They figured out how to survive for water, how to have their own water purifiers. They had everything that I thought they needed. And that is when it sort of humbled me, saying, holy shit, I don't ask nothing about this community. So we started talking to them, and we realized that one of the core problems they had was their electricity bills were coming extremely high. And we were like, okay, that's crazy. So you live in a one room house, you have a fridge, you have in some cases a television, you have a fan, and you have a tube light. how is it that your electricity bill is coming up to 10,000 rupees a month? That doesn't make any sense. So we looked at the electricity bills and we realized that the power corporation that has been supplying electricity to them have given them a commercial agreement instead of a personal household agreement, which is to say that the power suppliers in this case have sort of cheated them. And we realized that this is too big of a problem. We cannot go and fight against the power suppliers and tell them that, oh, why have you given this? It's going to be a multi-year long court battle and nothing is really going to come out of that. It is a systematic problem. So we asked people, how could we help you? You know, what would be an ideal situation in which this happens so that you're able to sort of control your expenses on electricity? And they said, Rishi, if I just knew why my electricity bill is coming so high, I would be able to make a behavior change or I would be able to figure something out. The problems that I thought was no electricity, no fans, no this, no that, no water, no education, no medical supplies. I realized all of my assumptions were absolutely wrong. They were rooted in some reality, but they were completely biased to what I think I could do. Just because I can make a circuit doesn't mean somebody needs a circuit. Just because I can make a mechanical product doesn't mean somebody needs a mechanical product. So it's very important for us to go and speak to people and understand what their actual problems are. And once I realized that their problem with electricity was not so much to change the electricity board, but their problem with electricity was just tell me why my bill is so high and what I can do with it. Because I cannot fight the system, but I can make a behavioral change. And that is a problem that we started working on as a team. And that is where we built something called the Bijli Budget, which is a small device that they could put to their core power supply. And like an auto meter, which they are used to seeing, a lot of them were auto drivers, a lot of them traveled in rickshaws. So we realized that, okay, this is something that they know. This is something that we can do, bridge this together. So imagine a small socket that you can plug into your main wall, right after your power switches. And as you use your electricity, it keeps showing how much money you have spent on electricity. And we took this back to the people saying, guys, you know, what do you think about this? And they said, oh, this is great. But you know what would be nice if I could budget out how much money I want to spend this month? Because sometimes I only want to spend 50 rupees on electricity in the month. Sometimes I only want to spend 500 because I'm saving up for something else. Can you help us with that? And with that, we did something interesting. We told them, you tell us how much money you want to spend this month on electricity. So they could input, say, 500 rupees using just simple buttons. They would put it on the wall. And once they start using electricity, the money would keep coming down saying, oh, you only have 480 rupees of electricity left. You have only 300 electricity left. And with that, they could be cognizant of their electricity usage and tap into what's going on. This is to say that this process will always help you to identify the real problem somebody is facing, not what we perceive for them to be problems or not what we think we can solve for them. All right, so I'm going to pause here. I would love to understand if you have any questions so far, you can unmute yourself. You can give it about 5 minutes. Or if you feel shy, you can drop a question or a comment in the chat box and I would address that. 5 minutes for questions. I would love for you to switch on your videos and show me your beautiful faces. Any questions so far? All right, there doesn't seem to be a question. Let me move on to the next slide. Meanwhile, if you do have any questions, sorry, go on. Sir. Yeah, please go on.
Sir, we are engineers, so we can people who don't know about anything.
Sorry, could you repeat that question? Your voice was breaking.
We see the problems which are involving about design thinking, but what should the people do if he don't know about, suppose I am an engineer, I don't know about medical things. If there is some problem in medical, medical area of course, then what can I do? How can I imply design thinking?
That's a great question, and I'll get to that in the next section, but let me address it here. First of all, that's a great question. Thank you for asking that. The question is, I am an engineer, and I know nothing about what's happening in medical field or say design or what's happening in rockets or what's happening in the government. How can I solve for it? So design thinking as a process is going to help you identify what a problem there is. You don't need to understand exactly how a medicine is produced, for instance. You don't need to understand the chemistry behind it. You don't need to understand the manufacturing behind it. You don't have to go into any of those details. You have to speak with people. You have to do research. And I'll show you exactly how that works to understand what are some of the constraints that I see in the system, right? I identify the system's constraints. I identify user stories within that. I identify, for instance, let's talk about medicine. Let's just talk about that. Something, for instance, that we noticed is there are not enough medicines reaching the people, right? So at the end of the day, it is not a medicine problem. It is a people problem that people are not getting enough medicines. So I start there. I do not worry about the backgrounds. I do not worry about the industries. I do not worry about the things that I don't know. I go and actively search and be actively curious about the humans being impacted and then find out from there, first of all, what are their problems? And then start going backwards from there saying, okay, you said you have this problem, but why is that a problem? And some of you would have heard this from Thabiso yesterday, which is critical thinking. Just ask a lot of whys to find out what the root cause of that problem is. And in that process, you will have a lot of learnings. Once you identify a root cause of the problem and you realize that, okay, this is a medical production problem, that's where you get somebody on board who understands medicines very well. You approach it from your engineer's mind. You get somebody on board who understands the medicine industry or manufacturing as a point, and that's when you start collaborating. So that's how it works. Design thinking cannot happen in your head alone. It always has to happen with people around you, with people from various different backgrounds. And one of the challenges, especially in engineering colleges, is we don't really know if there is anybody else on the team who knows another subject matter very well. So that's where you go and speak to experts. You speak to a chemist, for instance. You speak to a manufacturing unit. You tweet out to them. You do research. You find out what WHO, for instance, has to say about a certain situation. You do research, and that's the process of empathizing. And that's where we're going to go next. Does that answer your question?
Yes, sir. Sir, another question, sir.
Go on.
Sir, yes, please go on. If we think this particular problem in a broader area, that is many plans are implemented by state government, central government, but that are not reaching the people who are living in the village. Can design thinking can be implemented there?
Absolutely. That's a very good question, right? I am living in a certain city. I'm living in Bangalore. Can I do design thinking for somebody living in Bhagalpur, district of Bihar? Or can I do it for Kankroli in Rajasthan? Of course we can. Again, design thinking is human-centered. So in this particular case, even though you may know nothing about somebody in Bhagalpur, somebody in Durgapur, somebody in Kankroli, you have to reach out to them. How do you reach out to them? One, you find out if there is anybody at all that you can speak with there. It could be a community manager. Sorry, what am I saying? It could be a sarpanch. It could be an actual person there. It could be somebody from the village that you may find on a Facebook or a TikTok or a LinkedIn or a Twitter or whatever that may look like. Basically, go back from what we know and start driving from there. Sometimes you will know nothing about anything, right? I'll give you an example. A friend of mine is fundraising right now for some students in Manipur. And I had no idea about what's going on in Manipur because the media doesn't talk about it. Twitter doesn't talk about it. Facebook doesn't talk about it. LinkedIn doesn't talk about it. So all my sources of information are not talking about it. So how do I find out what's happening in a Manipur or what's happening in like Lakshadweep Islands or what's happening at Port Blair? I have no idea. What I do then is I actively start researching on whatever material is available out there. I may not be actively consuming that information, but I can do secondary research on it. I can go back and look for, what's going on in Manipur? Oh, what are some of the things that are happening there? What's happening with power supply? What's happening with education? What's happening with people? What is the money distribution there? What kind of students do they study? What kind of students are there? And I start doing that research. Once that research is built, that's when I start reaching out to one or two or three expert people that I know who may be from Manipur, who can help me sort of understand the problem a little bit better. So it always starts with understanding the human. It doesn't matter which part of the world. I could be solving for Brazil. I could be solving for China. I could be solving for a remote district in Russia. I can be doing for anything. But what's important is to get the human story. And how do we get to that human story is what I'm going to start speaking about in another minute or so.
Yes, I understand. Yes, sir. Thank you.
My pleasure. Any other questions? I can take one more question and then we can move forward.
Rishi, we have a
chat box.
Sorry, Nishant, go on.
Yeah, Rishi. So we have two questions in the chat. So I think it will be covered later on in one of the topics. So one person is asking how to properly do market research, especially mm-hmm. when the target public is, say, deaf or mute. Mm-hmm. That is one. And I'll give you another question also. He says, hi, I'm Abhinash from Odisha. For my project, how should I reach to NDRF or fire brigade teams? So,
all right, that good questions. Yeah, I'll speak about Abhinash's question specifically after the next section. But Divij, I think it's a great question. How do you do market research for somebody who's deaf and mute? So the human story there is people with disabilities or gifted people, so to speak. They are always with some form or the other of a carer. The carer could be their parents, it could be their brothers or sisters, it could be an organization they're a part of, it could be somebody in their school, it could be somebody else. So the human story there is that people with disabilities always have a carer around them. It could also be a life partner, but the core relationship there is always going to be of a carer, somebody who will be able to be with them, take care of them, and help them sort of navigate lives. So even though they may be deaf and mute and they may not be able to speak, you will be able to get through to them through carers. And I'll speak a little bit more about this in the next section as well. All right. Thank you for your questions. Please keep pouring the questions that you have in the chat box, and I'll keep coming back to them after the next sections. All right. Enough about design thinking and what it can do for you. Let's speak about the process. So design thinking is a 5-step process. The steps that you can see on the screen, there are 5. Step number 1 is empathizing. Step number 2 is defining. Step number 3 is ideating. Step number 4 is prototyping. Step number 5 is testing. The interesting thing here to note is these are all very fluid in nature. What that means is let me take an example of cooking. I've been cooking a lot, so let me give you that example. When I'm trying to make a sambar, I start with frying the, heating the oil or ghee, putting some mustard seeds, putting some garlic, some onions, some ginger, and then I put the rest of the ingredients while I'm boiling my dal on the side, and then eventually I mix all of them up. That is called a sequential process. Design thinking is not a sequential process. Design thinking is more of a circular process in nature, and all of these steps are intermingled. So you can start empathizing, but immediately after empathy, you may end up defining a problem to begin with, and then doing the rest of the steps for once. But then from any step, you can come back to empathy, trying to validate whether this is an assumption that we made, whether it's correct or not. Ideate, this is an assumption that we made, is that correct or not? To give an example of this further, one second. Yeah, to give a further example of this is what I just briefly touched upon earlier in the Mumbai slums example, where I went to the Mumbai slums in Dharavi with a certain set of assumptions. But then I went into the process of empathizing and understanding what the user story is, what their constraints are, so on and so forth. I went back with the team, defined a problem that we thought existed after the questions. We ideated on some solutions, we prototyped something. And when we went back to gathering feedback, we realized that, this is not what's going to work. We went back to empathy, we realized, the problem here is not that their bills are extremely high. The problem is that they want to be solved is how do I get cognizant of my spendings on electricity? That became the problem statement then. So I went back from ideating to empathizing, then prototyping to empathizing, then testing to ideating back again, and then prototyping again. So it becomes a whole circular process. And don't worry about if this is confusing you right now. We can speak a little bit more in detail. Today's focus is going to be specifically on empathizing. And over the next couple of weeks, each and every of these steps will open up. This week's focus is going to be on empathizing. Next week's will be on definition. The week after ideation, the week after prototyping, the week after testing. So that's how the process is going to look like. Let's go a little bit deeper into what empathizing means. So empathizing is a process. It's not a set of rules, restrictions, or dogmas, just to reiterate that, right? It can be executed in various ways, but the goal remains the same. Learn everything that you can about your user, get into their shoes, learn about their life, live that life. In acting, this process is called method acting. You may have seen Rajkumar Rao doing various roles. You may have seen Heath Ledger doing the famous role of Joker, or the new Joker movie, for instance, where Jacqueline Quinn, I'm forgetting the name of the new actor, I'm so sorry. If you know the name of the new Joker movie actor, please drop it in the comments. But they become the character that they're going to be playing. They think the same way, they feel the same way, their problems become similar. They're able to really get into the shoes of somebody. And that is what empathizing means. To be able to really understand in and out what somebody's feeling, what are they doing, what is their life like. The core questions that we always focus on answering at the end of the empathizing process are these: who's the user? What's their story? What's their context? What are their conflicts? What could resolve those conflicts? And what do you think their problems are? So, and I will do this short exercise with you to explain what this process looks like. But these are the core problems, these are the core questions we will continue to and always be looking for answers towards. Who's the user? What's their story? What's their context? What's their life? What do they do? What they didn't know? What do they not do? Do they listen to music? Do they dance at 3 a.m. in the morning? Like, what is their life? And through that process, you start understanding their actual story. So when you know somebody's real story, when you're in somebody's shoes, you're able to see the world the way they look at the world. Thinking about Turere earlier, I could have gone back to them saying, oh, let's play drums at like 5 p.m. every evening so that nobody comes close. Or let's light everything on fire. Let's have drones. Let's have more technology solutions, only because I can build technology. But the moment I understood his context and constraints, I would be able to go and say, listen, I know you only have, say, 300 rupees to spend. This is what we can do in 300 rupees. Same thing goes for a farmer. I can give very fancy ideas, but at the end of the day, I'm going to solve for the problems that they have within the constraints they have. The beauty of design thinking, I believe, is to be able to work within the constraints and bring out an innovative model. When you have unlimited number of money, unlimited amount of money, unlimited number of resources, and no time limitations, anybody can solve for any problem. But innovation happens when you have to work within constraints. And that's where design thinking sort of helps you. All right, moving on to, okay, thank you, Akshay, Jack and Phoenix. What is the difference between conflicts, problems, constraints, and a wider sense? Okay, I'll thank you for the question, Akshay. I will speak to you in detail as we go to the next process. I'm introducing two different methods of empathizing here. One is going to be by interviews, and another one is going to be by research. These are, again, processes, not dogmas. This is going to be a structure that you can follow. And I'll walk you through what that looks like. All right. Empathize with interviews. So empathize with interviews is essentially exactly what it sounds like. You talk to people, you interview them, actively, passively, in whatever form and shape, you observe them. And you ask questions. And some of the things that are very important in this process is this: it's important to listen and immerse yourself into their stories. Speak to people of your target audience. To the question earlier, if you want to speak for a village in Durgapur or Kankroli or Bhagalpur, you find a way to reach out to them. You speak with them. If you cannot speak with them, you find a proxy. You find somebody else who knows about their story, or you find a way to get in touch with them. Ask them leading questions. What does a leading question mean? A leading question is not, do you like red color or blue color? A leading question is opening in nature. It opens up the conversation, saying, what color do you like? Don't restrict their thinking, help them open up. With every question you ask, don't converge into what you're trying to get to. You open them up. You try to understand them more and more and more, and trying to understand, okay, what does this mean? What does that mean? Why do you do a certain way? Why do you not do a certain way? So on and so forth. Find out their stories. Find out their conflicts and struggles. Conflict could mean let me give a very simple example for this. Conflict for me, who is a very privileged person in Bangalore city, is, oh, the job market is going pretty bad. I don't really know what will happen in 6 months. So that's my conflict. I don't know what could happen in 6 months. My problem would be that, oh, what happens if my job goes away? That would be my problem. Conflict would be, oh, I don't know what happens if this happens. I don't know how I'm feeling because of all of these things that are happening around me. My maid didn't come today, or my electricity is off, or I'm giving a Zoom call, but my internet goes off. These are all the questions that could be potential areas of conflict. These are conflicts that I have. These are the problem. These are pseudo problems that I may have, or non-specific problems or problem areas that I may have. I may have a problem with respect to relationships. I may have a problem with respect to, work. I may have, problems with respect to food, electricity, so on and so forth. So that would be a conflict, a problem area, so to speak. A problem would be much more well-defined. A problem would be well-defined, saying, I want to eat food at 3 p.m., but I don't have food cooked at 3 p.m., what can I do? That would be a very specific problem. A conflict could be, oh, I may get hungry soon, what could I potentially be eating? So a conflict is a lot more philosophical in nature. It may not be impacting the person immediately, but it's a lot more philosophical. My school is too far, and I'm 8 years old, my school is too far, and my shoes are broken. I don't know how will I reach school on time. Or there is a huge river on my way to school, and every day I may have to figure out how a new way of crossing it. That becomes a conflict. A problem will be, oh, today I'm standing on the banks of this river. I need to go on the other side, but the current is too strong. What do I do? Do I go to the school or do I go back home? That would be a specific problem. Conflict would be more philosophical in nature. Right, next step, find out problems that they're facing, make notes as a team and compare. So in this particular case, you will not be working as a team. You will be individually, as of today, thinking about some of these problems and interviews. So just understand their problems, find out what the problems that they're facing. The more anecdotes from the user, the better. Try making sure that in the past of this interview, you can either record a conversation like through digital methods, or you can make notes. And if somebody says, "Arey yaar, I don't know if the salary is going to come tomorrow, and that's a big worry for me." So you make that sentence down, because that is going to help you keep grounded to what the user actually thought versus the interpretation of what you think he thought. The user may be thinking that, oh, what if my salary doesn't come? How am I going to worry about, how am I going to pay my friends and family or whatever? And how am I going to survive? But you may think, oh, the person is more concerned about whether or not the company is going to pay him the money. So maybe he should be speaking to the manager or something else. So you may perceive the same sentence in a different way. So that's why it's important that you have anecdotes. Try to keep your own biases away. Identify the constraints. What are the constraints that they're working in? Technical, educational, cultural, gender related, financial, more. What are the constraints? What are the things that are going to be within which you have to think around? What are the boundaries that you're going to that you're going to put to your thinking to think within? Find out about their behavior. How do they behave? What do they do? What do they not do? On a typical morning, if they get up, how do they feel? What do they actually do? What is a day in life that they do? What are their typical behaviors that they follow? If they're going to watch a news channel, what news channel are they going to watch? If they're going to eat something for breakfast, what do they eat for breakfast? The more you know about somebody's story, the more you're able to relate with them as a team. The next thing is the problems that we see they have. find out what have they already done to solve for those problems. Someone may say that, oh, you know what, I feel like I'm not able to work out. And maybe, and then you go and propose that, hey, what if we give you a home gym? And somebody will be like, yeah, that's great. But before you offer them a product or a solution, you have to ask them, what have they already done to solve that problem? Because sometimes we may think that it's a great problem for them and we should solve for it. But, and they may tell you that, but they may have actually done nothing to actually solve for it by themselves, which could be a good indicator that even though they think it's a problem, it's not an important enough problem for them to work on and solve for. The last thing is also use this time to validate with them whether what you think is a problem is an actual problem for them. Continuously go back and forth, ask what their problems are, what do you think is a problem versus what do they think is a problem, and continue to validate as a process. So this is empathizing with interviews, and I will quickly walk you through what this means. The next is empathize with research. Now, this is the thing that I was mentioning a little bit earlier. Empathize with research. So a lot of us may not be able to go out and speak to people, or if we speak to people, it'll only be the 3 or 5 people that we already know. So how can you still look for causes that we know are interesting to us? And this is like a framework that you can follow for that. Find out the spaces that interest you or crisis problems that have been drawing your attention. For me personally, it has been, for instance, the migrant crisis. I've not been able to speak to any migrants. They are not around me. They have all left the cities. They are on their way home. So I know that is a problem that I'm interested in to solve. And I choose that as a area of interest. Find out all possible angles to what's happening in that situation. The angles could be that, oh, you know, news one is reporting this, news two is reporting this, news three is reporting this, news four is reporting this. So look at media, but for facts and not opinions. I'm not asking you to look at primetime debates. I'm asking you to look for actual reporting. One of the best ways in which you can use media to your benefit is to look at all the news sources that you trust, and then all the news sources you don't trust, bring all of them together, look at the pointers that are common in both, but don't look at why they are happening. Make that conclusion yourself. Next, look for people of interest who have been interviewed in this time over videos. So if there is a migrant who has been interviewed by any of the media channels, look for their interviews, find out what their story is. You don't have access to them, but you at least have an access to a little bit part of their story. Now, once you've collected a lot of these, find out the patterns in their experiences, backgrounds, and conflicts. What are the common patterns, right? A common pattern that I've seen in migrant crisis situation is a lot of them were out of job suddenly and their employers stopped paying them. They had no way of eating food. They have no way of staying. Their rents were given up. A lot of construction workers especially have faced this problem. So these were all the common criteria that I looked at. Start building a collective document for these subjects. So if I am listening to say 5 subjects, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, whose stories that I've learned, I collect all of those stories together. And then I'm looking for these patterns and collectively looking at the problems that they may be facing. And then list out the problems faced by this collective group. So these 5 people collectively have faced out all of these problems is what I'm going to sort of point out. And then your activity for the day is going to be, making a list of those collective problems. All right, so these are 2 methods in which we can empathize that we are going to use today. I'm going to quickly look at questions right now. I see 3 of them. And then we are, just also making sure we are cognizant of the time. I'm going to go into the next exercise. Akshat asks, what is the problem between conflicts, problems, and constraints? Do conflicts mean constraints in wider sense? No. So a constraint would be a lot more specific. A constraint would be, I only have 300 rupees to spend in a month. A conflict would be, I don't have money. Or a conflict would be, I'm not making money. Or a conflict could be, I don't have money to spend. But a constraint would be a very, very specific, I don't have money to spend. And I only have 300 rupees to spend. A conflict, like I said, would be more philosophical. Problem will be a lot more defined. Constraint would be very, very specific. Couldn't understand how meters help the slum on getting the same commercial section. May allow less power, but they are still charged the same high commercial rates. Great. Sahil, thank you for the question. The problem that we noticed in that particular situation is the commercial connection is a systematic problem, which is a very difficult problem to solve. What they can do is behavior change, which is the much easier thing for them to do. So if I can, even with my higher rates, if I can limit my TV time, if I can limit my fridge time, if I can limit my other, or if I can budget out how am I going to use my devices, it still helps me save some money. It helps me being cognizant. It helps me become more cognizant about where my spendings are going to go. And that is how they are, they solve for it. For instance, I could have just watched TV for 10 hours straight. And then suddenly I then know that, oh, I have spent 100 rupees already. So then for the next couple of days, I can budget out my TV usage. That is how that impacts them. Okay, Akshat asks a follow-up question. So basically, conflicts are situation-based and problems are consequential. Not necessarily. Conflicts and problems are both situational. In a particular situation, a person could have a certain problem. In a particular situation, a person can have a particular conflict. But I would like for you to take a step back and not define exactly what a conflict will look like. Because as us as engineers, we try to dig deep into understanding exactly what that means and what is the exact definition. We have to keep it open-ended. A conflict could be, I don't have water to drink. Problem could be, I've not had water to drink for like 15 days and I don't know what to do with it. So it could completely change. And in the next example, I'll walk you through that. All right. Thanks for the questions. We'll go on to the next section where we actually do a research. Before we go to the next step, let me quickly show you what, I'm going to quickly share a template of what this looks like, and I'm going to help you figure out what that means. So empathize by an interview. I'm going to run a quick experiment and I'm going to eventually come back and fill the sheet up. And then I'm going to empathize by research and I'm going to quickly show you what this is. We are running short of time, so maybe not in detail, but I'll quickly show you what this means. The link to this document will be shared with you. So you will all be able to access this. And the your job for the day would be that if you are going to be doing an empathizing exercise with interview, do a minimum of 3 interviews. If you're doing it with research, do a minimum of 1 or 2 researchers. And towards the end of it, have a copy of this document ready for yourself. And I think Nishant and Dheeraj will tell you the next steps on how to put these problems. So these are the problems that you will be sharing with the rest of the people. But the entire document is what's going to remain with you. So when you actually go in the ideate session, you can come back to the stories and define. All right, Nishant, are you ready?
Yeah, Rishi. I'm ready.
Perfect. Are you nervous?
Yeah, man. My first performance.
All right. So don't worry. Everyone who's watching, notice the kind of questions I'm asking. Notice notice that I don't have a hypothesis in mind as to the problems that Nishant is facing. Notice. How Nishant is reacting and the kind of stories that I'm going to eventually be documenting. All right, Nishant, how are you doing today?
Yeah, I am feeling great. You know, like our internship is making some sort of positive change in people. And of course, I'm in my village. So, you know, the environment here is so nice. I feel great.
I'm happy to hear that. Where is this village and in which part of the country are you in right now?
In Bihar state, there is a district called Gaya, Bodh Gaya.
Bodh Gaya, of course, yeah.
So, yeah, the land of Lord Buddha. So in that district, there is a the district is divided into different blocks. So we have a block called Dumaria block, and in that block, I have a little village. It's called. I'll send in the chat. It's called Barwadi.
Barwadi, okay. Cool, thank you for sharing that. How far is Bodh Gaya? How far is the Bodhi tree from where you stay?
Around 85 kilometers.
Have you been there recently?
No, like I went there last 7 to 8 years ago.
Okay. Do a lot of people still come and see the Bodhi tree? Is that a tourist attraction?
That's an international tourist attraction, actually.
Right, but because of the COVID crisis, are people still coming there?
That I don't know, actually. Before this COVID crisis started, I was in Delhi.
Okay.
And before being in Delhi, I was in MNIT Allahabad, the incubator makerspace. I was working there, college closed. Then I had to go to Delhi because my family had shifted to Delhi. I was staying there. Then I thought that somehow we got to know lockdown happening or lockdown may happen or something like that. We got an inkling. Yes, I could ho sakta hai. And there is That's more right. danger in Delhi. So we just came back to village.
Okay. That's a smart idea. So now you've been in... So are you staying alone? Are you staying with your family?
Yeah, we have a total, what you call, joint family over here.
Okay. How many people in the family? What do they do?
We have five people in my immediate family.
Mm-hmm.
And seven people in my uncle's family.
Wow, that's a lot of people. That's nice. Is it good to, from NIT Allahabad, I'm assuming you'd be living in a hostel sort of a situation or a PG.
Yeah.
How does it feel to come back home and stay with such a large family again?
Yeah, it's always nice, man. Actually, see, you are now talking about only 12 people. But the thing is, in my village, right now, me and my uncle, our family is there. Then if you go higher in our family hierarchy, all the people are living nearby only. And we are one big family.
Wow, that's lovely to hear. I'm so happy to hear that. How has the lockdown impacted your life, Nishant? What are some of the things that that you have been sort of struggling with lately because of the lockdown?
Actually, you know what? Since I'm starting only when I went into the makerspace at MNIT Allahabad, I was really loving it over there. I had all these equipments and everything. I'm a kind of a electronic and a maker enthusiast. I try to make new things and interact with people and help them make new things. And I was doing that greatly in the makerspace. But due to this lockdown, I have been forced to go away from that place. Mm. And I'm missing the makerspace very badly, man. I want to go there.
Yeah, I feel you. It sounds like a very difficult... It sounds frustrating. How are you dealing with it? Are you doing something at home? How are you keeping in touch with your friends from the makerspace?
Yeah, all the people of cohort, they are in touch with me. Then the people before that, I'm basically from NIT Kurukshetra. I completed my BTech from there. So all my people from there, they are also in touch. So we are touch over phone and every time we talk and everybody's now this lockdown has brought some, economic slowdown. Most of my people are, my friends are in mechanical department.
Hmm.
I'm a computer science student, but somehow it happened. I used to be in a team, the formula student team. We used to make computer formula cars and Baja cars for competition.
Hmm.
So most of my friends are mechanical. And their industry has been hit hard. So now, we are also trying to do something since the starting only, when we used to talk, we used to see that not everybody is happy with their life, their corporate life. They were man, why we are dragging this life along? We don't have anything fun to do. Because the SAE team in which I used to work, those were crazy days, man. We had a project and we never slept for 1 or 2 months. We just kept on working and we never were tired. You getting? And after that, college ends and they will go to this corporate and then they lose all this thing. So, we are thinking that we must start something like that again to get that life back, man. So that's what we are trying to do.
Wow, that sounds beautiful. I can imagine that life. I back in college, this was back in 2014, I was also part of a smaller team and I remember working on these projects. If I were to ask you what your favorite memory from working on that project is, what would you say?
You know, I was primarily into the formula team. And in our team, our one of the main goal, or what you call the dream goal of that team, was to build the automated automated electronic gear shifting system, which is reliable. And after working for around 2 to 3 years, we finally made that happen. And you know, like we like ran into the endurance race of the event, and that thing worked perfectly fine. And like some of the, my team members, they are available over here, like Rahul, Yukta, and Rupasa. They are also they have come with me as the organizing team for the internship, because they have been working like this. So that's my very best memory.
I'm very happy to see that. So Nishant, tell me this. Again, life has changed significantly, right, since you graduated. And again, these are very unprecedented times. And I can see it in your face that you really miss working in a team. You really miss working hands-on electronics and all of that stuff. What are you doing? What could you, for instance, do? So in an ideal world today, if you had a chance, what would you like to do with the same set of skill sets where you are right now? Because I also understand that because of lockdown and because of all the restrictions that are going around, you can't really exit your village. You can't go back to NIT anytime soon. What would you like to do that brings all of that enjoyment back to your life today?
Actually, before this lockdown happened, before that also, I have been thinking more a lot about that. Most of the people who are graduating or who are about to graduate or who are in the college itself, they have no idea about direction on the life. They have no idea about what they want to do. They have no idea about how they want to do. Like basically, मतलब यहाँ पता ही चलता कि हमारी अपनी अंदर की इच्छाएं क्या हैं, हम क्यों कोई काम क्यों करना चाहते हैं. बस everybody is doing engineering, तो हम भी घुस गए भाई, अब चलो इसको भी घीच रहे हैं, but कोई खुश नहीं होता. So at least I want to do something so that people are able to find their own path. कुछ वो कर लें खुद से और वो खुश रहे हमेशा, इस तरह कुछ.
That is beautiful, Nishant. Thank you for sharing. Thank you for sharing that. So you were saying?
Yeah, means that's what my look of ideal world. Where people don't मतलब इतने दिनों तक जिंदगी खत्म हो जाती है, life खत्म हो जाता, but they don't get to know उनको करना क्या है, किस चीज को से मिलेगी, क्या मिलेगा, they don't realize it. So if they would realize in even after 20 or 25 years of age, it would be great, man.
Yeah, that is beautiful. And I'll tell you one story, right? Because mera situation bhi similar tha. I wanted to be a doctor. Main apne papa mummy ke paas gaya, and in the 11th I had taken PCMB and bio ke saath, which is a deadly combination. And then in class 12th, I told my parents ki, I want to be a doctor. तो मेरे माँ पापा मेरे को सोफे पे बैठाते हैं, कहते हैं बेटा तेरे से नहीं होगा, तुमसे नहीं हो पाएगा, मत सोच उसके बारे में, बिकम इंजीनियर. सो फ्रॉम मेडिसिन, विच इज व्हाट आई वांटेड टू डू, आई एंडेड अप बीइंग थ्रोन इनटू इंजीनियरिंग. बट आई वाज सो लॉस्ट. आई वाज लाइक ओके, लेट मी ट्राई एवरीथिंग. सो एक्सपेरिमेंटेड विद म्यूजिक, एक्सपेरिमेंटेड विद इलेक्ट्रॉनिक्स, एक्सपेरिमेंटेड विद लिटरेचर सोसाइटीज, एंड इवेंचुअली इन थर्ड ईयर आई केम बैक टू इलेक्ट्रॉनिक्स सेइंग यू नो व्हाट, बहुत मस्ती होगी, लेट मी सम ट्राई इलेक्ट्रॉनिक्स अगेन. एंड दैट्स वेयर आई स्टार्टेड बिल्डिंग अ लॉट ऑफ दीस थिंग्स. And eventually now, fast forward, I graduated in 2014, 6 years later, I realized that my interest lies in understanding why people function, how they function. Because even when I think about it as a doctor, I'm more interested ki yaar, unko wo pareshani hui to usko deal kaise kar rahe hain? Unko ye pareshani hui kyun? Hum log aisa kya kar sakte hain ki wo pareshani dobara na ho? It was less to do with post-diagnostics, which is humko pata hai ki is insaan ko diabetes hai. It was less to do with that. It was more to do with kya re aisa na ho, hum log uske liye kya kar sakte hain. So that has been my realization. So I completely understand, where you come from and your sort of space of an ideal place to be. Nishant, I have maybe two last questions.
Okay.
Two more questions. Question number one. In the village that you're in right now, what have been some of the conflicts of the people that you see around them? What are some of the challenges that they are facing these days?
In the village, life is going almost normally.
Oh, lovely. Interesting. Are the schools disrupted for the kids who are going to school? Are the sales of food items? Okay.
Schools are disrupted everywhere, but the best thing in a village is that every household, almost every household, grows its own food. तो लाइक वो दाल चावल जो खत्म हो रहा है राशन खत्म हो रहा है वो चीज हमारे यहाँ पहले से होती तो दैट्स नॉट अ बिग इशू द ओनली थिंग इज लाइक सम ऑफ द अदर आइटम्स लाइक व्हाट यू कॉल जस्ट इन लाइक सॉल्ट एंड ऑल दैट यू टू गेट अ शॉर्टेज बट समहाउ दैट आल्सो गॉट मैनेज्ड बाय द लोकल डीलर एंड ऑल द ओनली थिंग इज दैट ड्यूरिंग द स्टार्टिंग लॉकडाउन व्हेन इट वाज टोटल स्ट्रिक्ट Then, like, neither we people went out or nor we did allow anybody else to come in the village. That was there. At that time, there was little bit of tense. But then after that, it came back to normal.
All right. This sounds great, Nishant. Thank you so much for sharing that. So this is basically... everyone else, this is basically how I would like do a very high level interview. You will realize that I'm not going deep in anything, but I would love for you to notice how I sort of make some notes. Name of the person, Nishant. What's their story? Well, Nishant is an engineer. Ayo, if I could only spell E-N-G-I-E. Engineer by degree, but loves working in teams, draws a lot of inspiration and energy from working and collaborating with people right from college days. Has been very active with hands on things. Anecdote to support this was right from college, Nishant has been in SAE and Baja. Baha clubs, what are, okay, very hands-on things. He recently moved back to village and now lives with an extended family, but originally a few months ago he was at NIT. Which NIT was this, Nishant?
MNIT Allahabad.
MNIT Allahabad. Then he briefly moved to Delhi but reached his village right on time. Time for lockdown. All right. So this is a brief about who Nishant is and what is his story. Likes and dislikes. Likes working in teams. Enjoys village life. Likes talking to people. And collaboration. One thing I'm also going to write here is cares deeply about people. Okay, dislikes. Doesn't like the fact that he doesn't have access to makerspace. Um, is not happy with how his friends are facing difficulties in their job. Doesn't like the fact that people in their colleges just do things because everyone does. And of course, this can go into a lot more detail, but what is their motivation? So this motivation I'm deriving from the quick conversation I had about you as to what the ideal world would be. So their motivation, as according to my derivation, is in an ideal world. No, hang on, wrong sentence. He is motivated by the impact he can create especially for students in colleges. He would like to create a world where people know why they are doing something, and find meaning in their work. What are the conflicts and challenges? Conflicts in this case would be he's worried. Conflict could be people that he knows of are a little lost in life or are living life without any meaning. That could be a conflict. Challenge that he's facing would be no access to makerspace, not being able to meet people, so on and so forth. Constraints. Constraint number one could be limited to village geography. Limited to no access to tools, to electronics. Let's just put it electronics. Could be one of his constraints. Third constraint could be, since he lives in a village, possible power cuts or internet outages. Okay, another thing that is coming in my mind is he likes the village self-sustaining lifestyle and enjoys it. Okay, another constraint could be that, potentially phone bills, etc., could be one of the constraints that he may have to do. A potential constraint could also be that job market, no, that would be more of a conflict. Economy is slowing down and jobs may be lost. That's a conflict that he's living with and would actually want to actively help. My conflict, challenge, and this may hinder the kind of impact he wants to create. Okay, these are some of the very high level constraints, and we are running out of time, so I will just sort of close it soon. What could help them? These are my own hypothesis. Problems, I will write about this. How are they feeling about this current situation? So far, so good. But can see in his expressions how much he misses the old life and way of doing things. Okay, some anecdotes, we can add more here. What could help them? Well, here are a few ideas. Finding ways in which he can continue to create meaningful, exciting projects could be one of the things that we could do to help them. Enable him to support the kind of change he wants to create. That could be another one. This could be something else that we could help him with. One thing that I think could be a problem, but may not be, is in times of calls or collaborations, find ways in which he can get quiet surroundings. This is something that I may learn from a conversation with Nishant, saying, okay, there was a little bit of traffic, there was this, and maybe he was unable to concentrate. Maybe I saw some hesitation when he was speaking because there was all of that. So that could something that we could help him with. And this is where I start defining the problems a little bit further. So I've written some constraints, I've written some other ideas. This is where problems come into play. Problem number one, and these are all assumptions till now, but this is the problems that we think exist. Problem number one, unable to create impact. And you will see that some of these are very similar to the conflicts, some are very similar to, say, dislikes and stuff. Unable to create impact. Let me put it in a different way. Is not able to find as much excitement and gratification as pre-lockdown. That is a problem. And these will continue to change, right? The other one would be by building things. So this becomes a lot more specific, that I had access to makerspace and I could do a lot of experiments, but now I'm unable to do them, or I'm not able to do them at all. So this is a problem that we think they are facing. They're not able to find as much excitement and gratification as by building things. NGS. Another problem statement could be reaching out to friends and helping them find their whys. It could be a problem that, no, hang on, let me rephrase this. I made a note. Problems we think they are facing. Not able to create as much impact with, I'm just going to just write it down, helping people advice. As you would like. It could be a problem. And one last thing, again, it's an assumption, could be a wrong one. Flexibility, yeah, like to work the way he would like remotely. since a lot of his work is in person while talking. So this is a, all right, so this is sort of how the document would look like. We are running like an open thing. And again, depending on the question that you are pushing and like how you direct the conversation, the problems could be a lot more specific. For instance, if I could speak to Nishant for another 30 minutes, I could find out exactly the problem that he's facing. And I could be like, huh, so Nishant said that, you know, so and so and so is happening. And he's trying to connect with people, but his friends are not available on the phone, or the internet connection is not strong enough that he can speak with them, so on and so forth. It could be that in the village, schools are disrupted, so the kids in the mothers don't know what to do with the kids around. So that could be a problem that maybe Nishant is not facing, but he has seen being faced in the house. So I'll start writing all of those problems here. And that's how this would continue. Okay, I'm going to pause here for a minute. I think we are running a bit late. I'm open to questions for 5 more minutes, and then we'll just take 5 more minutes after that to walk you empathy by research and just like direct you how that goes. All right, everyone, open for questions. Please use the chat box to drop a question or just unmute yourself and ask a question.
I just want to ask, the kind of interview you took from Nishant, the similar kind of interview, how could we take from someone like my kind of perspective is the problems faced by a farmer. So I'm not used to talking to someone of that that field. So will he be open to share the problems going with him?
That's a great question, Deepika. And thank you so much for asking that. conversations at the root of everything are a human construct, right? A human connection. It's the responsibility of the interviewer to build that relationship with the interviewee and make them comfortable in sharing that experience. And some of the things that you can do is, one, speak in the language that they understand, they are comfortable with. Second is share your own story, share your own perspectives. Be ridiculously curious about what's going on in their lives. And you have to be sincere about it. So people open up. I've spoken to thousands of people, I guess, in my sort of life so far in doing projects and researches. And my situation was a lot different. I was in China and I spent a month there and I was doing a project with some of the people there and I wanted to understand their stories. I didn't know the language. The only way we could communicate is I will send them a question on WeChat in English. It'll get translated to Chinese Mandarin. And then they would see that in Chinese that they would respond to it in Mandarin and then it'll come back to me in English. But even there, I built a relationship. And how you do that is you find common grounds, you find common stories, you find common narratives. I, for instance, when Nishant shares that, oh, you know what, people are so confused and they don't really know what they're doing. They just follow the status quo because everybody else is doing it. I will continue doing it. I go back to him and say, you know what, I've had a similar experience. And by sharing that experience, I connect. Now, in the case of a farmer, you may not be able to connect with experiences as much because the privileges are very different. You couldn't say that, oh, you know, my AC was not working. But you can connect saying, mausam achha nahi ho raha hai. You know, mausam is not nice. And pani mein gadbad hota rehta hai. And, you know, dekho sarkar kya kar rahi hai, mere ko nahi samajh mein aa raha hai. So on and so forth. So you can find similar spaces of a conversation and build on top of that. Does that answer your question?
Yes, it does answer.
Okay. Next question, please. I'm looking at the chat box. There are no other questions. Any other questions, guys?
One same question. When I was working for women's safety, so we started with we will make an app, kind of device which will help them reach from one place, A place to B place safely.
Mm-hmm.
But when get into the broader concept, like working for it, and we find more and more problems, at a point of time, we were unable to decide what we want to do. And doing the market analysis also, we found out ki, this is something that has already been built, but is not working or helping, or maybe it is useful, but they are not using it.
So again, a very good question. This is something that I think all of us face in whatever forms and shape of work that we are doing. So this is what I'll tell about my experience, right? Design thinking goes back to the human. So if you're designing, if you've already in your mind said, I'm going to make a safety app, you're already constraining it. But before you start building it, go back and speak to 50, 100 different girls across all ages and find out what makes them feel safe. And not ask them if an app is going to make them feel safe. Ask them what makes them feel safe. Ask them, okay, so you know, there are a lot of issues with women's safety. What do you currently do to feel safe? Do you carry something with you? Do you walk in groups? What's the human nature? What's your story? What's your behavior? What are your constraints? And most people in my case have told me that what I do to feel safe is to walk in the daylight, is to only take the streets which are already lit by light. I always walk in groups. I do not take autos in the night, especially in Delhi. I will continue to chat with a friend, or I will sort of put my headphones on and, you know, just keep somebody on the phone saying, listen, I'm walking, so on and so forth. If I take a ride in the night, I will make sure that I take the picture of, I take the front picture of the car or the auto, and then I send it to like two or three people I care about. Ask them, what are they actually doing for it? Because most apps are built because you can build them, instead of asking and going and asking the people whether they actually need it. That's one. And second, ask them, why is it that they have not used any of the apps? And in most cases, you will realize that they are not really helping them in any way. Like a panic button, for instance, doesn't really help. Ask them what do they actually do and what are their natural responses? Because if somebody is feeling scared, they're not likely to open a new app on the phone and type something and then do something about it. They're more likely to follow their human instinct. That's why, you know, understanding that story is important. Okay, two more questions have popped up. One is from Rishabh, saying sometimes people are reluctant to share how to handle that. That's a great question, Rishabh. You have to make them feel comfortable, and you have to continue to communicate that you're not trying to extract something which is personal. You just want to know their experience, and you want to see if there's anything that you can do to help in your capacity. You have to always sort of continue to reiterate that. Abhinash, coming back to your question, government organization, NDF, NDRF or fire service, what you have to do in that particular case is find somebody who you know works there, or just call them up and tell them that, hey, this is something that I'm working on. Will you be interested to talk? In spaces like this, when you have to reach out to authorities and public figures, what works the best and the only way that actually works, that has proven to work, is to build a human relationship there. Get to know somebody who knows somebody inside. Speak to your, say, college. Maybe someone from there knows somebody in the government institution. It's going to be a little bit of like a this process, but that's what you have to do. You just have to sort of go and speak with them. And they're busy in the pandemic, of course. Like that is also going to be this case. So in this case, what I may also recommend is, instead of going them and asking questions, do some research, see if there are some resources that are already done, see if there are already interviews that can be done, so on and so forth. Just do secondary research. All right, everyone. I will take 5 more minutes to showcase Empathize by Research, what this means. And then we can open up for the next 5 more minutes of questions and conclude the chat today. All right, Empathize by Interview. Now you understand a little bit more about it. Empathize by Research. Step number one. What are the problem areas that are capturing my attention? It could be COVID-19, migrant crisis, or shortage in essential supplies, global warming, communal tensions, racial tensions, water and electricity problems, bullying, mental health, gender-based violence issues, grassroots innovations, urban planning. It could go across. Just find something that you sort of feel towards. Don't pick a problem which you don't feel inclined towards, but only just because it's a huge problem doesn't mean it's something that you will be good at solving in the long run. Pick something that you are interested towards and curious about. Now, what are some of the root causes of this? You write a few hypotheses of your own that, oh, migrant crisis is happening because of this, this, this. Now, once you have identified some root causes through critical thinking and root cause analysis, which you all sort of were a part of yesterday, now look for some data points. Look at what the media is talking about. Look at what NDTV is saying. Look at what BBC is saying. Look at what Al Jazeera is saying. Look at what Aaj Tak is saying. Look at a local news channel. What are they covering? Look at Instagram stories. What are people saying about that? And sort of start collecting these stories. Identify the human stories behind it. I find out through interviews. I remember watching this interview 2 days ago that there is a guy who was walking all the way from Pune to, I think, Vijayawada. And on the way, when somebody stopped him and said, why don't you just stay in Nagpur? And he was crossing by Nagpur. He said, Nagpur mein rehke kya karenge? I might as well go home. It's only going to take me like 5 more days. And he was distraught and he was like, I don't have money in my pocket. So get all of those stories in place. What are the common patterns across these stories? You will realize that, say, in migrant crisis, a lot of the people on migrants who are farmers and stuff, they were promised a lot of money hitting their accounts in the Jan Dhan Yojana or something like that. But the money has only been 500 rupees in some cases. But the losses that they are incurring are in lakhs and crores. So, like, how does that sort of work? Right? So find out the common patterns across those stories. Maybe a government or a public institution failed them. Maybe their employers failed them. Maybe they were just living in situations where it was not possible to do social distancing. It could be any of those, right? What are the problems is where people, these are the places where you again go a little bit deeper, saying the problem that is being faced, which is not apparent, but I can see that is this person is walking for like 20 days straight with limited food and water. They have no water supplies. They have no this, they have no that. That could be some of the problems. It could be the emotional trauma that somebody is going through. It could be like all of these things. So you start writing them down. Then you start talking about why are they facing the problems in the first place? You go back to what are the causations of this. And then you sort of list down problem hypothesis, saying, okay, my hypothesis number one is the government failed the people. Hypothesis number two is, you know, if the government would have just announced lockdown with enough time, people would have been able to make sense of it. Hypothesis number three, if people could have had sustainable sources of revenue and sustainable sources or community efforts that could feed them where they are without a worry of whether the food is going to come to them tomorrow, maybe things would have been solved. So you make a list of all of these problem hypotheses, and that's your job for the day. Sorry, I had to very quickly rush through. We are very short on time. And this is typically like a 3-day process that I introduce. I try to cram it all up in an hour and a half. So empathize with the interview. Try to do at least 3 interviews today with the people you know, the people you don't know. And try to empathize by research, which is to say, reach out to, again, do your research, find a place that you're sort of inclined towards and try to solve for that. All right, 5 more minutes for any final questions, concerns, inputs, and then perhaps Nishant or Dheeraj could share the next steps with all of you. The chatbot is open. You can also feel free to unmute yourself and ask a question.
In the current situation, how is it possible to contact the higher authority, like the police persons, related to some problems, like for the similar problem, women safety. We were thinking like there are apps that have been made not by individuals. There are apps that have been made by the government, Delhi government and all. So I don't have such kind of apps in my phone. Or I tried installing and thinking whether I'm using it or not. Well, before questioning some other person, why are you not using that app? I should question myself that why I'm not using it. So that kind of like was not that okay. That dialing that number at that current situation where I'm just stuck. I don't know what to do.
Okay, so Deepika, again, thank you so much for this question. Right. you will go a little bit deeper. We'll take you a little bit deeper into this process over the next couple of weeks. But again, go back to the human story, right? You cannot say that you know the answers to this yourself. So ask people, like, why are they not installing it? Your answers are not enough in this. You are solving for a particular target group. Ask them, why are they not installing it? In my experience, in most cases, you don't need to speak to authorities, especially in the initial space, where, because you're not pitching a product or a solution to them. Unless your question is more specific to, you know, Mr. Police Wala number, whatever, 911, why do you think people are not using it? They will not be subject matter experts in this, because the question to them is not about what is police doing about women safety. The question is, why are people not using the app that is given by the police or the department? They're not the subject matter experts in this.
Not questioning them, but I'm talking about, like, if some similar kind of app that I'm building with some better features than that. So I obviously need the policeman contact for that app support. Like people, we were thinking, like, the police can immediately contact that person or could see the location. So in that case, we need their approval first.
Right. So that's a great question again, Deepika. What you are doing right now is you're defining, you're basically in the last stage, second last stage, which is prototyping. This is not the ideation stage. I would rather focus primarily on speaking more on the ideation stage right now, but the question is good nonetheless, so I'll answer it. When you're in the prototyping stage, the only thing that you can do right now with everything that's going around is just call people and see if they'll be open for a conversation. Go back to your school or college who may have a contact in the police. I know this to be true in Karnataka, like every sort of area has a designated constable. And their numbers are available. Call them up, speak to them, find out if they will be open to this and will be okay to work with this. You also have to realize that while you're pitching this as a solution to them, if it's increasing their work and it's increasing their noise, which is unnecessary, they may not actually use it. So there could be a time where, you know, the girls are actually pressing a panic button or they're trying to do something, but the police constable is in a million other things and he may not be able to respond. Maybe that's not the right way of going about it. So even before you pitch that product to them, speak to them about what their life is. So again, you will have to do the research here, not just from the women's side. You will also have to do research from the police side. How are they handling these cases right now? Are they understaffed? Are they getting paid enough? Do they have resources enough to reach somebody someplace in time? Do they have a phone which can support all of this? Do they have chargers that can support their phones with all the calls that will continue to come? So on and so forth. So you will have to do that research first before you start talking to them, pitching, saying, oh, why don't you come on board and, you know, we'll give you this app. That's not how it will work.
Thank you.
Okay, I have one more question.
Hi, sir. Am I audible?
Yes, you're audible. Go on, please.
So I heard of a certain scheme or idea which the central government was trying to implement about making cooking gas by converting the sewer gas, especially in the villages. Under the
CO means the carbon monoxide?
Under sewer.
Got it.
So, but they failed miserably at it. I thought about getting some information about it, and I basically gained that the people were not just using the gas. They thought that the gas was filthy or it had some smell associated with, which was not true. So how would we conclude at a solution here by getting this idea, by implementing this idea?
So this is what I would suggest. Go and speak to 50 to 100 people. Villagers who will be using this eventually, find out what their concerns are. The thing is, in this country, we really underestimate human psychology. We really don't care about it. Especially when we are designing a scheme like this. Now there are so many nuances to sewage that I can't even begin to talk about it, right? There's a caste issue that only a certain caste should be picking up the sewage and should be dealing with that within the sewage system. So it's going to go and put it there. Then the next thing is human poop or human pee is considered to be unpure in India. And they don't look at it as an ingredient to something. They look at it as an excreta of their bodies, which is impure, right? That is a system. Now, villages are also very heavily defined by the caste system. So if somebody who's from the upper caste and they have a janehu, they will put like the janehu on their ear and go to the washroom and go to the toilets, right? Open defecations or otherwise. So there are just so many of those constructs. So if you're telling people that I will bring gas from your shit, your poop, to your kitchen, which is the most impure thing to the purest place where you cook, they will not use it because there are so many inherent biases. So you need to do research on finding out where would that inherent bias go away. Now, maybe human poop is not a solution. Maybe cow poop is a solution. Maybe bakri poop is a solution, right? Maybe the sewage center could be repurposed with cow dung and all the other animal poop instead of human poop. And they will be okay for that because cow dung is purer, so to speak, right? Cow dung theplas are used across India for various religious purposes, for cooking purposes and all of that. So the problem there is that you'll be trying to solve is going to be that of a cultural construct and not a technical or a social cause. So you have to like understand culturally where they're coming from and what is it that they would like to work with. That's what you will have to do.
Thank you, sir.
Okay, I have a question from Somanyu. Should I have a knowledge in different traits to be able to solve problems and find solution, or would it be fine with knowledge in a single trait? That's a great question, Somanyu. What I would recommend is get really good with your customer understanding or your user understanding. Really get to know your problems. And once the problems are constructed, find people who are domain experts in those spaces. Now, a domain expert in this could be, for instance, Nishant. Nishant knows about how to build a community, right? So if the problem is that a community needs to be built, maybe you can speak to Nishant. He does not have a degree in it, but he knows how to do it. So you get a domain expert there. If you're trying to build a rocket science solution, get in touch with somebody who first knows how to make firecrackers. So you can build a very low fidelity prototype to even experiment whether this new design of rocket will fly or not. Get really good with your user stories and get really good with your research. And then find somebody who knows a little bit more about the domain that you are trying to solve for. That would be my suggestion. One more question by Prakasha. So in India, most of the land cases are there and most cases are pending for a year or so. That can't solve. And also fake land cases are high. Most people are going through it. So I think about working on it. Okay, one more question from Abhishek. Which of the two are actually more reliable way to find a problem or the cause? Empathize with research or interview? So Abhishek, it's like, should I be cooking on gas or should I be cooking on induction? It's the same thing because the end product is cooking. Whatever suits your cause, you have to look for that. So if I'm making baigan ka bharta, I cannot make it on an induction electric cooktop. I need gas. Similarly, if what the problem that you're trying to solve for needs for you to do secondary research, that's the route that you're going to take. If you don't have access to the people who you can actually speak with, for instance, you will not have phone numbers of people living in Leh and Ladakh, but you can, for instance, look at Sonam Wangchuk, who's actually doing videos about what's happening there. So that really depends on, you know, the problems that you're sort of inclined towards and what kind of discovery you're doing. Prakasha, thank you for, you know, pointing the thing about land cases. I think it's a good problem to explore, but what I would recommend is to find out why are the land cases stuck? Is that a government problem? Is that a court problem? Is that an advocate problem? Is that a people problem? Is that a document problem? Is that a accountability problem? What is the root cause of that? You need to first identify with that. And once you've identified, then you can start working on it. And you have to also realize that in this case, which is more systematic, which can't just be changed by speaking to 5-10 people and helping them make a behavior change, systematic problems typically need for you to influence the system. So you have to also find out if you will be in a place to sort of influence a court or a government scheme which could, you know, make the land cases go faster. So you will have to look at all the other constraints there. All right, I think that's all the time we have. I'm sorry, I will have to drop off soon. But thank you so much for your questions, everyone. The link of this document, I'm just sharing it over chat, but I think Nishant or Dheeraj will share it with you over an email also, I think. But you can essentially access this document. You can just create a copy and you can use this as a format for doing the interviews that you're doing. Your to-do for the day would be to do 3 empathy interviews at the minimum. If you have more time, you can do more. Spend 45 minutes to an hour on doing an empathy interview with the notes. So you can actually get to know somebody deeply. And if you have any questions that I can solve for, we'll connect later in the week anyway. But my email is hello@rishigb.me. So you can just reach out. Wait. Where is the chat? Yeah, this is my email. Oh, sorry. I think I only sent it to Sumanyu by mistake. That's my email and I'm sending you the document link. Feel free to, you know, shoot me any questions. I'll try to get back to them as soon as possible. All right, thank you. Nishant, over to you.
Thank you very much, Rishi. It was a really, you know, eye-opening session, even for me. I also didn't know that, you know, we could be empathizing in such a way. You know, like when you took my interview, and after that, when you were writing the points, I was like, okay, this could also be one of the points.
Yeah.
So, yeah. Like, that was really great, man.
Thank you. I appreciate that. Well, hopefully we'll, as you know, as we are all in this process, we'll all do more of these user interviews. And at the very least, we'll get really good at connecting with people and asking them questions.
Yeah. So, and also like while I was talking, I think you observed and like there was some disturbance. So you got the need that I need a quiet environment.
Yeah.
That's actual problem.
Yeah, because I could see it in your face. I could see it in your face that you were disturbed by it. So I was like, huh, okay, this may be a problem.
So yeah, guys, so you see that, right? While interviewing, you have to, you know, look at the people also, like their expressions also, like that. Or if you are not able to, like, do a video or face-to-face stuff, at least you can, you know, while talking, try to understand their why speech and all. That can also give you lots of insights.
Yeah.
And one more thing, like, I understood from you that do not leave any data point. ऐसे दिमाग में लगता हो कि ये तो इरिलेवेंट है ये क्या ही इसका जरूरत होगा बट वो काम आता है
बिल्कुल सही बात है हर चीज काम आती है
ये काफी अच्छा लगा मुझे आगे इसको करते हैं मैं भी ये कर सकता हूँ क्या
हाँ जी बिल्कुल एवरीबॉडी कैन डू दिस आप भी कर सकते हैं
मैं भी ट्राई करता हूँ
ठीक है परफेक्ट थैंक यू सो मच निशांत वी विल कनेक्ट अगेन वेरी सून
या मैन Okay, see ya.
See you. Bye-bye. Bye, everyone.
Okay, you can drop off if you have to go.
Okay. Yeah, cool. Thank
All
you.
All right, guys. Bye. So, okay. See you, Rishi. Okay, guys. So, just wait for a few more minutes. We'll be giving you last minute's instructions for the day. So, meanwhile, you got this, what you call, link in the chat. So, you need to open this link and I know, you can just make a copy. Like you just open it in your web browser and go to file and make a copy and then edit into that document. After that, by the end of this day, we will send you a Google form or something like that. Through that, you just need to, you know, send the link of your document to us. That will be nice and we will be having the document of everyone and you can keep your document because now your problem solving has started. And as I said in the starting, that will be taking you out of your comfort zone and making you think. So this is where it starts. You have to come out of your comfort zone. You can make a copy. If the document is read only, don't worry. You can make a copy, I guess. You don't need to... you got the point, right? So the thing is, today, your screen time is over for now. Too much screen time is also not good. So this is that much. Now you just have to find out some people around you or get some people on phone. कोई भी हो सकता है जिससे आप बात कर सकते हो, उससे इस तरह के इंटरव्यू वगैरह करो and try to find out, like do some analysis. क्योंकि यही चीज है, आपको अंदर में देखना पड़ेगा कि उस पर्सन की लाइफ में क्या चल रही है, कैसा चल रहा है, और वहां से आपको प्रॉब्लम्स नजर आएंगे, फिर उसको सॉल्व करते करते यू कैन हैव लॉट्स ऑफ इनोवेशन वगैरह निकल करके आएंगे एंड यू कैन हैव लॉट्स ऑफ न्यू आइडियाज एंड ऑल. And you will also, of course, feel good when you know. मतलब आप कुछ ऐसा कर रहे हो जिससे दूसरों की जिंदगी में बदलाव आ रहा है and they are making happy. Like you are the reason for smile on other people's faces. So that will be a good feeling. But that thing starts from here. Like you have to understand people. So that's what you have to do. You take this document, open it in your laptop or mobile, or at least copy this link for now. Yeah, nice. Yeah, it feels great. So copy that link for now and then make a copy. Then do your interviews either by empathy or by research. Then by evening, we will share you a Google form link. And it's important for everybody to submit that. All right. Any question regarding this? Yeah, फिर सब कुछ समझ आ गया?
So okay, so yeah. Abhishek had asked which one of the two is more reliable way to find problem or cause, empathize or research, I mean research or interview. So I guess you should always go with interview, because that way you get the finer human touch that is always needed to figure out what exactly is the conflict, as Rishi had put, and to, you know, figure out the details. But in some cases, like as Rishi said, right, they are trying to do something for money. So in some cases, you are not able to connect to that person directly. In that case, you can go with research. So just choose your focus area, start talking to people, always prefer talking to people first. If you can't, then I'll say go for research. Is that good now, guys?
Yeah, that's like good. And yeah, interview of any person can be good, because not everybody's like what you call life is perfect. Everybody has some problem or all. So, you know, you can find out problem in anybody's life. All right. In your document, you can either do interview or research or whatever. You can do anything. Or you can also do like two interview, one research. That also you can do. It all depends on you, how you want to do, what you want to do.
Yeah. So guys, this will be your activity for today. Just we'll share the same document over email also, the link to the same document. Make a copy, start working on it. Whatever you choose, the interview part or the research, it's up to you, or you can do both. And then by end of the day, today or tomorrow early morning, we'll be sharing with you a Google form in which you have to basically link this form. I mean, link this template that you have with you, the copy you made, and then also fill out the problem statement. Not the problem statement, because that's not the right term. Let's call them problem hypothesis. In the end, where Rishi wrote, right? Rishi wrote, right? Some problem that Nishant is facing, or he feels Nishant is facing. So those you have to fill out in the Google form. So yeah, that'll be the work for us today, people. Then we'll meet tomorrow again, 11 o'clock, Nishant.
Yeah, we'll be just having a short meet of around half an hour, just for agenda of the day, because tomorrow is the team formation day.
Yes. So tomorrow's the fun, guys. You work on this today, and tomorrow we'll do team formation. But you have to close this out today for that. And We'll meet once in the morning for briefing around 11. We won't try to extend it more than half an hour. And we'll have one more call probably around 3, a quick call to close out the discussion on team formation and all that. That has to be done. All right, chalo, sorted. So,
all right, so get ready to work. And let's have some amazing interviews and let's, build up our personality. Because see, by doing this interview, you will be able to, learn how to understand other people. Or ye karte hi aap, matlab aap ek, you start becoming a better human because you are able to understand other people. So, kya pata, you become a hit, more hit among your friends and family.
Yes. Okay. So just one small note from me before we close. So always, guys, try to understand the difference between empathize and sympathize. So you're not trying to, feel for something. You're just trying to understand what the other person is feeling. So feeling for something is sympathy. You're feeling sad because the other person is not doing well and all. That is good. But empathy means truly understanding what the other person is feeling. That is important for the problem solver to have. Okay. I think that's all. We can close now. Thank you, guys. Bye-bye. See you tomorrow.
All right, guys. See you again. चलते हैं।